Hi friends, welcome to my YouTube channel Dr. Srinivas Medical Concepts and my Facebook page Dr. Srinivas Concepts. This is Dr. Srinivas, neurologist from Andhra Pradesh, India. I am also the medical author of the book Focused Neurology. Today we are going to discuss a very exciting and perhaps a challenging topic, apraxia. So, what is apraxia? Apraxia is designated as a complex motor act, difficulty in performing a learned motor act despite pyramidal, extrapyramidal, cerebellar, sensory, and an understanding or comprehension being intact. So apraxia is defined as a disorder of a learned motor act despite pyramidal, extrapyramidal, cerebellar, sensory and comprehension being intact. To put it very simply, all systems regarding a movement are intact despite these movements being these subsystems which are responsible for movements being intact, a person is not able to perform a learned motor act. That is apraxia. So, a difficulty in performing a learned motor act is apraxia. Fine. What are the types of apraxia? Very interesting. There are ideational apraxias, idiomotor apraxia, and very fascinating sympathetic apraxia. So before I dwell into the actual topic of apraxia, we need to understand certain basics. I'm just simplifying it so that it is very easy to understand. Basically, we need to understand about two lobes to understand apraxia. One is the parietal lobe, especially the left. The left parietal lobe is responsible for planning the movement. So the left parietal lobe, which is the dominant cortex, is responsible for planning a movement. How to plan and perform? The planning is done by the left parietal lobe. It is an integrator of visual, auditory and somatosensory information. So integrator of visual, auditory and sensory information. It has a time-space plan. So basically, left parietal lobe is responsible for planning of a movement. Fine. The frontal lobe is responsible for performance of the movement. So frontal lobe is responsible for the actual performance of the movement. So if you understand these two concepts, it's very easy to understand apraxia. So parietal lobe is for planning of a movement, and frontal lobe is for the performance of the movement. These are the two organs through lobes which are responsible for an apraxia to appear if there is a dysfunction. Right. To test apraxia, again we need to understand another two concepts. One, the conceptual part or the imagination part, and two, the actual performance with the tool. So when you want to test a person who is probably suffering from apraxia, you need to understand two concepts. One, the conceptual or the imagination, and second, the actual performance with the tool. What is this imagination or the conceptualization of a movement? For example, without giving a real tool, ask him to imagine and then perform. For example, ask him how he brushes his teeth without actually giving a brush, or ask him to perform an act as how he combs the hair without actually giving the comb. So this is very complicated, more complicated than actually performing the movement. So performing the movement becomes a ritual habit. Just give a comb, he combs, or just give a brush, he can brush his teeth. But without a tool, to imagine and then perform an act It requires, it's very complex and it requires a lot of imagination and planning. So, imagination and planning of a movement is more difficult. It is done in the parietal lobe. When you give the actual tool like comb and then ask him to comb the hair, or give him the actual brush and ask him to brush his teeth. So the actual performance of the movement is done by the frontal lobe. So imagination is done by the parietal lobe, where you don't give a real lifetime object. The actual movement is done by frontal lobe, where you give a real lifetime object and ask him to perform. You have understood these concepts, now understanding upper axis is easy. So now let's come first to the parietal lobe involvement. If the parietal lobe is affected, it causes what is known as idiomotor apraxia. So if parietal lobe is affected, it causes idiomotor apraxia. So if there's a lesion in parietal lobe, what happens? The planning of a movement is gone. But the frontal lobe is intact and therefore they can perform with the actual real lifetime object. So if parietal lobe is affected, if there's a lesion in parietal lobe, the planning and imagination is affected, but actual performance with a real lifetime object is intact. So in these patients, if you ask them to imagine how he combs his hair without the actual tool, he cannot perform the act. He cannot imagine. He has seen the pattern or the movement sequence, the sequence of movement, he has forgotten. But when you give the real comb, a real lifetime object comb, he can easily perform the act of combing. So when you ask him to imagine, plan a movement and then do, because parietal lobe is affected, which is responsible for planning, he cannot perform the act without the real tool. But when you give the real object, in this case comb, he can happily comb the hair. This is known as idiomotor apraxia. So, in idiomotor apraxia, they have no problem at all in activities of daily living. Because when you actually live and when you actually do activities of daily living, you perform the activities of daily living with actual tools. You get up in the morning, you take a brush and you brush your teeth. Once you have a shower, you take a comb and you comb your hair. So with real lifetime object, they have no problem in performing the movement. So these persons will not have difficulties in activities of daily living. So idiomotor apraxia, they have no problem with activities of daily living. In fact, it is a doctor who tests the patient and finds out that he is suffering from idiomotor apraxia. Fortunately, idiomotor apraxia is more common in clinical practice. Fine. So idiomotor apraxia, the lesion is in the parietal lobe, the planning or imagination is affected, but the performance with the real lifetime object is intact. Right. Now let's come to the ideational apraxia. In ideational apraxia, the lesion is in the frontal lobe or parietofrontal connections. So the lesion is in the parietofrontal connections. So whatever the parietal lobe has plan, it is not able to transmit the information to the frontal lobe for the actual performance of the movement. So when there is idiomotor, when there is ideational apraxia, the lesion is in the parietofrontal connections on the frontal lobe. So here, since the parietal lobe is intact, the planning and imagination is intact. So, if you ask them how you comb the hair without the actual comb, they can do it. Or ask him to write as if he's got a pen and ask him to write, he can. But the performance with the real tool is affected because the parietofrontal connections are affected. So, with the tool, with the actual tool, he is not able to perform the act. The goal-directed activity or the sequence is lost. For example, you ask him to imagine and then write with the pen, he can. The imagination is intact because the parietal lobe is intact. But since parietofrontal connections are gone, the real performance with the real lifetime object is affected. The sequence is gone. It is broken up. In bits and pieces he can do, but he cannot perform in a goal-directed activity. So, when you give him a pen and ask him to write, he might take the cover and put it on the wrong side, or he may put the cover correctly, but instead of writing with the, he may uncover it correctly, but instead of writing with this end, he may write on the other end. Or he may think the pen to be a nail and he starts hammering it. So, he cannot perform with real lifetime objects. Since he cannot perform a movement with a real lifetime object, his activities of daily living are impaired. So, in ideational apraxia, the activities of daily living are impaired because with the real lifetime object, he is not able to perform. He himself volunteers to the doctor saying that, I have problem with activities of daily living. So, to put it very simply, in idiomotor apraxia, the activities of daily living are not impaired, but with the ideational apraxia, the activities of daily living are impaired, and idiomotor apraxia is more common than ideational apraxia. Fine. Now, let me talk about another interesting apraxia, which is known as sympathetic apraxia. Sympathetic apraxia. Again, we need to understand certain concepts, then understanding sympathetic apraxia becomes easy. So, if I ask to perform an act with the right hand and left hand, what happens? If I ask the patient to comb with the right hand, he takes the right hand and combs. If I ask the person to comb with the left hand, he takes the comb with the left hand and combs. Fine. But when I give the instructions for him to either comb with the right hand or with the left hand, first he needs to understand what I said. So first, whatever instructions I have given to the patient, it goes to the vernix area. Whether he uses right hand or left hand, whatever the movement may be, whichever side it may be, it has to go to the vernix area. Now vernix area tries to understand. The first example we take with the right hand. So when I ask him to comb with the right hand, first it goes to the vernix area. From the vernix area, which is on the left side, the language area is on the left side. So if I have to use my right hand for combing purposes, it goes to the left frontal cortex, the hand motor area, and then descends in the medulla oblongata, crosses over to the opposite side and goes. So there's no problem at all. So in this person, in sympathetic apraxia, there's a lesion in the corpus callosum. Where there is a lesion in the corpus callosum, the body of the corpus callosum, anterior to the sternum of the corpus callosum, there is no problem with the use of right hand, because when I need to use the right hand, I don't need corpus callosum at all. From the vernix area, it tries to understand in the left auditory area, goes to the left vernix area, then goes to the motor hand area on the left side and descends straight away to the medulla oblongata and crosses over to the opposite side. I use my right hand for combing purpose, absolutely no problem, because I don't need corpus callosum at all. But now imagine that I want to use my left hand. I have to comb with the left hand. So I ask the patient to comb with the left hand. As with the right hand, the information goes from the auditory apparatus to the vernix area. But if I need to use my left hand, my right hand motor area has to be activated. So the information has to cross from the vernix area after having understood from the left side to the right side. So I need corpus callosum for transfer of information from the left side to the right side. So if there's a lesion in the corpus callosum anterior to the sternum of the corpus callosum in the body or in the anterior part of the corpus callosum, this information cannot be transmitted. But the right frontal cortex is intact, so I can do all kinds of movements. But information to perform an act like combing the hair is not being transferred from the vernix area to the right hand motor area because of the lesion in the corpus callosum. The information is not being transformed. So I'll perform in all kinds of awkward ways. So my movement will be completely awkward. It will be disorganized. Because the information is not coming from the vernix area to the right hand motor area where it tries to understand and then send out the impulses. So the way I need to use all permutations and hands, the planning, everything is gone. Because the information is not being transmitted from vernix area to my right hand motor area because there is a lesion in the corpus callosum. So I cannot perform the combing, any act like combing the hair, I cannot perform. And this is known as sympathetic apraxia, because the lesion is in the corpus callosum. It is not in the right frontal motor area. The right hand motor area is per se intact. It is only the connection to the right hand motor area is affected. That's why it's known as sympathetic apraxia. So in sympathetic apraxia, they have a disorganized movement on the left side of the hand. If the sympathetic apraxia is serious enough, is so severe enough, then the person will not be able to control the movement of the hand itself. It seems to be alien. It goes into the pocket, takes out, it goes and touches someone and then comes back. The movements are completely unwarranted, unnecessary, and not under the control of the person at all. It seems to be alien. That's why it is known as alien hand syndrome. So a severe form of sympathetic apraxia leads to alien hand syndrome. So this is a broad overview of apraxia. I hope you have enjoyed it. If you have enjoyed it, please like and subscribe my YouTube channel, Dr. Srinivas Medical Concepts, and my Facebook page, FB page, Dr. Srinivas Concepts. Bye. Thank you.